Knowing the signs and symptoms of hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism is important for the USMLE. I won't read the list to you, but you should spend some time covering up one side and then the other to make sure you know all of the signs and symptoms and which ones occur in hypo versus hyperthyroidism. In general, all of the symptoms of hypothyroidism involve slowing things down, whereas the symptoms of hyperthyroidism involve speeding things up. Please pay particular attention to the lab findings. Low free T4 indicates hypothyroidism, and high free T4 indicates hyperthyroidism by definition. Hypothyroidism can either be primary, if TSH is high, or secondary/tertiary, if TSH is low. Similarly, hyperthyroidism can be either primary, if TSH is low, or secondary/tertiary, if TSH is high. Take some time to think through what I just said in terms of feedback inhibition within the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. There are many different causes of hypothyroidism. Hashimoto's thyroiditis is the most common cause of hypothyroidism, and one you should be very familiar with. Hashimoto's is an autoimmune disorder, and antimicrosomal and antithyroglobulin antibodies are typically found in the serum. Antimicrosomal antibodies are now also called antithyroid peroxidase antibodies, and you may see either term on the USMLE. An association with HLA-DR5 and elevated risk for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma has been observed. It's worth noting that although Hashimoto's is the most common cause of hypothyroidism, it can actually cause temporary hyperthyroidism early in its course due to rupture of thyroid follicles and release of thyroid hormone. Histological examination reveals classic Hirthle cells and lymphocytic infiltrate with germinal centers. It is known that both T cells and B cells are present, but it is not known if one cell type has greater importance in the pathogenesis than the other. Clinically, a typical finding is a moderately enlarged, non-tender thyroid gland. Cretinism was discussed briefly before, but let's remind ourselves of the salient characteristics. This is a disease that afflicts children when there is hypothyroidism during fetal development. As you may recall, thyroid hormone is necessary for bone growth and brain maturation, so both of these processes are compromised. And additional clinical findings include potbelly, pale puffy face, protruding umbilicus, and protuberant tongue. Cretinism is usually caused by maternal hypothyroidism, generally in areas where goiter is prevalent from the lack of dietary iodine, but it can sometimes be caused by a defect in T4 formation or a failure of thyroid development. To prevent iodine deficiency, what common food supplement is iodized? That's right, table salt. The third form of hypothyroidism is subacute thyroiditis, previously known as de Carvan's thyroiditis. The distinguishing feature of subacute thyroiditis is that the thyroid is quite painful and tender. The disease typically occurs following a flu-like illness, and it is self-limited. Other findings include an elevated erythrocyte sedimentation rate, or ESR, jaw pain, and granulomatous inflammation on histology. Like Hashimoto's disease, subacute thyroiditis may involve a brief period of hyperthyroidism at the beginning of disease onset. In Riedel's thyroiditis, the thyroid tissue itself is replaced by fibrous tissue, so there are not enough follicular cells remaining to produce the required hormone levels. On physical exam, you will find a fixed, hard, or rock-like gland, and it will not be painful. Some other less common causes of hypothyroidism include congenital hypothyroidism, iodine deficiency, goitrogens, Wolff-Chaikoff effect, and painless thyroiditis. Goitrogens are substances that interfere with iodine uptake and suppress thyroid function. We talked about the Wolff-Chaikoff effect in the physiology section, which refers to a transient decrease in thyroid hormone levels as a result of excess iodine ingestion. Painless thyroiditis is also known as subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis and is a subtype of Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Now let's look into hyperthyroidism. Toxic multinodular goiter is characterized by focal patches of hyperfunctioning follicular cells that are autonomously overproducing thyroid hormone. They are not responding to TSH or the lack thereof because of a gain-of-function mutation in the TSH receptor. The thyroid is enlarged with multiple distinct nodules, but the hot nodules in this disease are rarely malignant. The Jod Basedow phenomena describes a situation in which patients with iodine deficiency goiter actually experience thyrotoxicosis if the iodine deficiency is corrected too rapidly. The thyrotoxicosis in this case has similar clinical features to that observed in other hyperthyroid disorders. A commonly tested disorder, Graves' disease, is an autoimmune disease, specifically type 2 hypersensitivity, and it is defined by the presence of antibodies against the TSH receptor. These autoantibodies stimulate the thyroid in a manner identical to TSH. The distinguishing features of Graves' disease include protrusion of the eyes, known as exophthalmos, as shown in the picture, and an infiltrative skin condition on the shins called pretibial myxedema, which are only seen in Graves' disease. In addition to diffuse goiter and all of the other clinical signs and symptoms of hyperthyroidism noted previously, the disease frequently presents during stressful situations such as childbirth. Thyrotoxicosis or thyroid storm is a complication of Graves' disease, as well as other hyperthyroid disorders, where a massive release of thyroid hormone induced by stress causes a catecholamine surge that leads to cardiac arrhythmia and potentially death. Thyroid cancer can be a complex topic, but luckily for this exam, you just need to know the basics. We'll mention the different types of thyroid cancer and the critical details of each. Papillary thyroid carcinoma, or PTC, is by far the most common type of thyroid cancer. It carries an excellent prognosis, meaning it is usually a disease that people die with rather than die of. It has been associated in numerous studies with having received radiation to the neck during childhood. On histology, the key features are empty appearing nuclei reminiscent of Orphan Annie's eyes, seminoma bodies, which are round collections of calcium, and nuclear grooves. Seminoma bodies are also found in papillary renal cell carcinoma, papillary ovarian serous cyst adenocarcinoma, meningiomas, mesotheliomas, and prolactinomas. The arrows in the image point out Orphan Annie eye nuclei, as well as nuclear grooves and intranuclear pseudo-inclusions. These are examples of a seminoma body in the context of PTC. Note in the left image that there is a single necrotic tumor cell in the center of the seminoma body that probably acts as the nidus for the formation of the structure. Follicular carcinoma is the next most common thyroid cancer, and it also has a generally good prognosis. Pathologists frequently have a difficult time differentiating follicular carcinoma from simple adenoma, but uniform follicles point in the direction of carcinoma. Medullary carcinoma derives from the parafollicular C cells and produces calcitonin. Histologically, one sees sheets of cells within an amyloid stroma. It is inherited in about 25% of cases, often associated with the MEN2A or 2B syndromes, so patients should undergo screening for the other aspects of those syndromes. The final thyroid cancer is undifferentiated or anaplastic thyroid cancer. This is extremely rare, but it carries an abysmal prognosis. It is more common in older patients. One other tumor that frequently occurs in the thyroid, though it is not derived from intrinsic thyroid tissue, is lymphoma. In an older patient presenting with a neck mass and signs of cancer, a differential between lymphoma and anaplastic carcinoma is often considered. Lymphoma is far more amenable to treatment and is generally associated with Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Alright, we're leaving the thyroid and moving right along to the parathyroid. We'll start with hyperparathyroidism and describe its primary, secondary, and tertiary forms. This image is from the hypoparathyroidism section, but it pertains here as well. Hyperparathyroidism is associated with the classic mnemonic stones, bones, and groans for the typical symptoms of calcium kidney stones, osteoporosis, and muscle soreness and constipation. Patients typically complain of weakness, fatigue, low appetite, and often have depression or other psychiatric issues. Primary hyperparathyroidism is usually caused by a parathyroid adenoma, which can be uniglandular or multiglandular, or less frequently can be caused by gland hyperplasia. Laboratory findings include hypercalcemia, hypercalciuria, and hypophosphatemia. Because bone is being broken down, one also finds high levels of alkaline phosphatase. Osteitis fibrosa cystica is a complication of hyperparathyroidism in which cystic bone spaces become filled with brown fibrous tissue, resulting in soft, deformed, and painful bones. Parathyroid hormone levels are by definition high and is the cause of the other findings. Cyclic AMP levels in the urine are elevated because PTH binding to PTH receptors activates GSG proteins to stimulate production of cyclic AMP by adenyl cyclase. Often, this disease is discovered before it becomes symptomatic through routine calcium testing. You will note primary hyperparathyroidism appears on the upper right corner of the diagram below, which indicates that these patients have a high PTH level causing a high calcium level. Secondary hyperparathyroidism is a frequent complication of chronic kidney disease. As kidney function worsens, there are fewer cells producing 1-alpha hydroxylase, and thus vitamin D cannot be converted to its active form. With less active vitamin D, there is poor absorption of calcium from the GI tract, and the hypocalcemia triggers the parathyroid gland to secrete more parathyroid hormone. This leads to bone breakdown, hyperphosphatemia, and elevated alkaline phosphatase levels. Serum calcium levels are still lower than normal because of poor GI absorption, despite the increase in PTH. The bone lesions seen in this disease are known as renal osteodystrophy. On the diagram, you'll find secondary hyperparathyroidism in the top left-hand corner. This indicates that there is a low calcium level and lack of negative feedback results in a high PTH level. Tertiary hyperparathyroidism occurs as a sequela of secondary hyperparathyroidism. After the parathyroid glands have been chronically stimulated by constant hypocalcemia, as we just described, occasionally they start to autonomously produce parathyroid hormone. In this situation, they have essentially become large adenomas. Serum levels of PTH and calcium are both high. Hypoparathyroidism is uncommon. In fact, a major cause of disease is accidental surgical excision of all of the parathyroid glands during thyroid surgery. On the exam, be on the lookout for a patient with symptoms of hypoparathyroidism after thyroid surgery. However, it can occur endogenously, and this is either from autoimmune destruction of properly functioning glands or from agenesis of the glands as seen in DeGeorge syndrome. Hypoparathyroidism in the diagram is in the lower left-hand corner. Insufficient levels of PTH results in a low calcium level. When there is not enough parathyroid hormone produced, the major result is hypocalcemia. Two clinical tests can be done at the bedside to determine if a patient has hypocalcemia. The first is Shostak's sign, where you tap the facial nerve and look for signs of facial muscle contraction. The second is Trousseau's sign, where you occlude the brachial artery for a few minutes using a blood pressure cuff and look for spasm of the carpal muscles. Patients may also notice tingling around the lips as an early sign of low calcium levels. Lastly, there is an entity known as pseudo-hypoparathyroidism, previously known as Albright's hereditary osteodystrophy. This is an autosomal dominant disease in which the kidney does not respond to parathyroid hormone. There is enough parathyroid hormone in the body, but it has no effect on its targets because of a defective receptor, so patients end up with hypocalcemia. Other associated features include short fourth and fifth digits and short stature. There is one circle in the diagram we haven't discussed yet. Looking at the bottom right, we see a group of patients with low parathyroid hormone levels but high calcium. In these cases, we know that the high calcium levels must be inhibiting the release of parathyroid hormone, so the source of calcium cannot be bone breakdown driven by PTH. Instead, the calcium is coming from excess calcium ingestion or perhaps breakdown of bone by metastatic cancer.